concert that Eugene Normandy conducted in the Brisbane City Hall in August 1944, and it was an augmented Brisbane Symphony Orchestra, heavily augmented with players from the South. And it was an incredible night. It was a turning point for me, I can assure you. I'd been to a few schools concerts Sir Bernard Hines had conducted, but this was the first major evening concert that my parents took me to. He did it with no baton, no score, and did the most dynamic performances that you could imagine. It was something that must have bewildered my parents, because even before that, when I would have been about 9 or 10 or 11, they'd seen me standing in front of our old radio set, waving my arms around, conducting whatever music was on, presumably the ABC. They surely must have been bewildered, but I can't explain it. It was a driving force for as long as I can remember. I was in my last year of primary school, 1946, and on my 14th birthday, I played under Eugene Goossens in what was his first, not only Queensland, but Australian concert. That was very exciting, and he made a bit of a fuss on me as a budding young, you know, precocious young flautist or whatever, but it was a great night. I felt awed, absolutely, but very excited, and it stimulated me. It was that sort of thing that made me more determined than ever to follow this path in music. I'd worked under Joseph as a very young flautist and as soloist in one of the very first youth concerts that the ABC presented in Brisbane in 1948, it would have been, June 1948. And I always admired Joseph Post as a conductor, a really first-class Australian conductor, orchestralian of opera repertoire too. And I had the temerity again to go to him after one of the rehearsals in the with the Queensland Orchestra when I was a member, and said to him, Mr. Post, and very naively, I mean, you don't ask a conductor this sort of thing, but I said to him, Mr. Post, I want to become a conductor of a symphony orchestra. What should I do? And Joe had a rather sarcastic, laconic sort of streak in him, which used to come out in rehearsals every so often. And he said to me, he looked at me and said, with his tongue in his cheek firmly, Patrick, there's nothing to it. All you do is learn to beat 1, 2, 3, or 4 in a bar, and the rest is up to you. And unfortunately, the rest is the most complex and most difficult part of it, as I found out. He auditioned me. He gave me an audition. It would have been in August 1963, which was the turning point. This was the turning point which took me out of administration, office administration, and back into the orchestral ambit. And he gave me half his rehearsal with the QSO to rehearse Ober and Overture of Weber and the First Symphony of Schumann, the Spring, and some Czech sight reading that Rudolf Pekarik had put together for me. Not terribly easy either. I'd sweated profusely for an hour and a half, and Joe sent the orchestra home and said, oh, that was very good, Patrick, very good. But there are two things you've got to do. All young conductors work too hard. You work too hard. And for Christ's sake, keep your bum in. Don't crouch and bend over the orchestra. And I've tried to keep it in ever since. I had just embarked on an audit trip for this company I was working for. They had 30 odd branches around Queensland, and I barnstormed around there along with the other two auditors. And I had just landed in Wandoan to do the branch audit for the year, and I got a telegram from my wife, Helen, to say that the Elizabethan Theatre Trust Opera Company and Australian Ballet had appointed me a resident conductor for 12 months. As a result, I'm pretty sure of Joe Post's audition. I had to prove myself there. That was a baptism of fire like no other. I was given 3 days to learn the score of Fledermaus. I'd never conducted a symphony orchestra in public, let alone a full theatre production. I was taken down to meet the leader of the orchestra, who blanched noticeably when he heard I was conducting that night. And then up to the stage, Walter Stiesny, the senior conductor, took me on stage, and the cast had assembled. And Peter Grant, who was the visiting English Eisenstein in the production, addressed the company and said, Patrick Thomas is conducting tonight. All I can say is, ladies and gentlemen, good luck to you, Patrick, and bloody good luck to us. I must say, with the trust for that year, 1964, I knocked over about 150 performances. John Hopkins had decided to revamp or to reclassify and the position of conductor of the Adelaide Singers, the last surviving national radio chorus. And they were advertising this newly vamped position that John Hopkins, as the new director of music, had envisaged and planned, very similar to one he had held himself in Scotland, I think it might have been, in his very early BBC days. And it was the assistant conductor of the South Australian Symphony, conductor of the Adelaide Singers, conductor of the Adelaide Philharmonic Choir, three concurrent conducting appointments, and for good measure, 12 hours administrative work as well. I'd been in Adelaide 8 years. I'd been off at the Tasmanian Orchestra. I decided to go back to Adelaide because I felt there was more work to be done there. And then 3 years later, at the end of the eight-year period in Adelaide, I was offered the Queensland Symphony Orchestra. I'd been up there doing the odd subscription concert over the past 2 or 3 years, and an opera of Larry Sitsky, the House of Usher, we recorded it up there with the cast and the orchestra. And I was offered the job, and I was very thrilled and a little bit intimidated, perhaps, because a lot of the players had been in my own years as a player 20 years earlier. But it was very exciting, and the Queensland Orchestra, I think, proved what a wonderful ensemble it was during those 5 years. I decided I wanted to make it as broad a repertoire as I could, and that's what we did. A lot of contemporary music was introduced, a lot of Australian music, and not only Australian, but overseas contemporary composers were introduced. So there were schools concerts and there were new music workshops. That was another of my requirements. I was required to start these new music workshops as a platform, as a forum for contemporary music and Australian compositions once again. And quite a number of Australian compositions were given their premieres. It always will be a struggle, because for decades now, Australian audiences have become used to the formula that the overseas name has to be better. This was a price, I think, that we paid for the ABC's great pioneering work in bringing these tremendous celebrities from overseas. The equation has two sides, and that's possibly disadvantageous to local conductors, and maybe to an extent local artists too. But the fact is that it was always difficult. John Farnsworth said to me on one occasion, "You know, Patrick, it is more difficult for an Australian resident to become conductor of a state symphony orchestra than it is to be selected for the nation's first 11. And, you know, he made that comment to me 40 or 50 years ago. It still applies to some extent.